Hello everyone, and welcome to part 5 of my building review series about a diorama with the title The Crash. In part 4 of the series, we have already painted and weathered the T34. Now it's time for the StuG III. I'm going to take the same approach I have demonstrated on the T34 in the previous video, but of course there will be a few small yet very specific differences. In this video, I will show you the complete process of painting and weathering the model. First of all, I separate the model again to get a few handy components, which makes the painting process a bit easier. Some modelers prefer to paint their models as a whole, while others break down their models into even more components. How you proceed here is entirely up to you. It depends on your style and also on the model. In this case, there are not too many components to remove. The ends of the tracks are just pinned together, and the wheels are just glued on the axles with water-soluble PVA glue. Those get plugged onto shish kebab sticks, which makes the painting process easier. I will paint the metal tracks the usual way, because I still haven't got me any of the various burnishing fluids. In order to make it easier to handle the tracks during the painting process, I add a wire loop on the end of the tracks. This prepares the model for the painting procedure. Some modelers use some alcohol to degrease the model at this stage, but I think this is not necessary. Now we apply a black base coat on all the components of the model. For this I like to use matte 9 anthracite by Revell. As I have already explained in the video about the T34, I don't consider the base coat as a technical necessity to improve the adhesion of the paints. I do it because it provides a uniform base color, which ensures the color fastness of the following paint applications. Our model consists of various materials in different colors, so the Panzer Gray, which will be the uniform main color of the model, would look different on the light gray plastic, the photo edge parts, or the copper wires. This means that you can use any other color for this purpose as well. Gray and white are good choices. However, black has the big advantage that it can shine through in some places in the end, which even helps us to create some very interesting shading effects. The adhesive power of Revell acrylics is very good anyway, so a primer coat in a technical sense is not required. It is very important to apply the color in thin and even layers. Make sure that no bare plastic or metal shines through anywhere. Next, we paint the visible interior of the StuG III. For this task, I am using this paint set by Life Color, which is designed for German and Italian armored vehicles. I'm using the color German Elfenbein. The term Elfenbein, meaning ivory, is often used to describe the interior color of German armored vehicles, but the terms Cremeweiß, cream white, or Grauweiß, gray white, are also a thing. There are even different descriptions in the literature and in old documents when it comes to the somewhat reliable RAL numbers. Sometimes the color is called RAL 9002, sometimes RAL 1013 or 9001. In my opinion, it is sufficient to use a plain white color, which got tinted a little bit with sand yellow or beige. That should be enough to represent the real thing. Once the paint has dried, I cover the big hatch on the roof with masking tape and remove the white overspray with Revell Matte 9. Now we can apply the actual vehicle color. I'm using Revell Matte 78 Panzer Gray to represent the typical RAL 7021 paintwork, and a bit of Matte 79 Blue Gray, which I use to accentuate some areas of the model. RAL 7021 is also a subject for discussions with other modelers and tank experts, which get easily out of hand, but of course you rarely get any helpful information this way. I'm certain that the color was much darker and certainly not as bluish as many modelers like to believe, but this is only my opinion. it's important that you like your model in the end. Otherwise, all the work was for nothing, and that can't be right. As I have said already, I stick to a pretty dark gray color, which I apply on the entire model. Then I add a little bit of matte 79 blue gray, which gives the color a slightly brighter tone, and I use this color to accentuate a few panels and sections of the model. The effect is not very striking, but it helps a little bit to add more depth to the model, without overdoing it, as we often see it with the color modulation method. Now we can put the airbrush aside for a while and pick up some brushes instead. It's time to paint the details. I like to start with the rubber parts of the wheels, which I paint with Revell Matte 9 Anthracite. This color is the perfect tire color. For some reason, this task is one of my favorite things about this hobby. Painting the wheels is very relaxing for me. Those of you who are no Zen masters in that regard can use some wheel painting templates. However, I don't think that you can complete this task with the templates any better. The exposed bare metal on the sprocket and idler wheels, where the paint gets grinded off by the tracks, is represented with Revell Matte 90 Silver. The same color is also used for the headlights. For the metallic parts of the vehicle tools, I'm using a mixture of Revell Matte 91 Iron and Matte 9 Anthracite. One could actually keep the tools as they are, because they often got painted in the same color as the rest of the vehicle, but it looks better to paint them in a different color. We modelers often have to deliberate about whether to keep it all realistic or make the model visually attractive. This can be hard to decide, especially when we take it all too serious. For the wood, Bakelite and compressed paper grips and handles, I give this color set by Ammo by Mika Dry for the first time. Unfortunately, I am a little bit disappointed by this color set. I don't know why, but for some reason the paints had little chunks in them, which led to a quite messy and uneven finish. The two dark colors, Gunmetal and Shadow Rust, in this set are pointless in my opinion, which is the reason why I used a mixture of Revell colors for the metal parts of the tools earlier in this video. Well, at least I learned something new. The grips of the wire cutters get often painted in various wooden colors, which is wrong. These grips were actually made out of compressed paper, which had a very striking red-brown color. I recommend to use a strong red-brown color, like Revell Matte 37 Brick Red. Since we are already using a reddish paint, we can also paint the reflectors on the rear with a red color. In this case, I used Flat Red by Vallejo. This completes the detail painting of the vehicle itself. Now it's time to paint the stowage on the engine deck of the StuG III. I used a couple of Revell paints for this task. This is a good opportunity to apply some artistic license. You can use some striking colors, which add a bit of contrast to the model and make those details really pop. The last stage of the detail painting process deals with the tracks. The tracks received a black base coat along with the other components of the model at the beginning of the video. To replicate the dirt and rust patina on the tracks, I apply a misty coat of Revell Mate 84 leather brown. There are a lot of places on tank tracks where the bare metal gets exposed, even on the inner faces, as we can see on this Jagdpanzer 38, which is in running condition. Due to the permanent contact with the wheels, any dirt or rust gets grinded off very quickly. In order to simulate that, I paint the inner face with Revell Mate 91 iron. One could actually use some sanding paper to expose the bare metal on the tracks, just like I do on the outer face, but somehow I prefer to paint the inner face anyway. Finally, I apply a dark brown acrylic wash on both sides of the tracks. This completes the detail painting process and we can move on to the decals. The decals, which come with the kit, do not really match the markings we can see on the vehicle in the reference photos, so I use various spare decals I happen to have. In addition, I am using a decal set for the Tetra fire extinguisher by Pettinghaus. Instead of spraying a layer of glossy varnish on the entire model, I just brush it on those areas where a decal will be located. This saves varnish and time. For obscure reasons, the arrangement of the labels for the fire extinguisher is not the same on the decal sheet and the instructions, so I cut it all out so it can be rearranged in the correct way. Since Pettinghaus printed the decals on one big carrier film, we can't get around this task anyway. The application of the decals works the usual way. I dip them into lukewarm water for a moment and wait a minute for the decals to dissolve from the paper sheet. Right before I slide the decal from the paper backing, I apply some Microsol decal softener on the area where I want to place the decal. This helps the decal to conform to the surface perfectly, so the emblem looks like it's painted on in the end. Once the decals have dried, I glue the wheels to the vehicle and seal it all off with a layer of semi-gloss varnish. I made the semi-gloss varnish myself by mixing Revell 01 gloss varnish and Matte 2 with a mixing ratio of 50-50. This prepares the surface of the model for the now following weathering process. To me, the first step of the weathering process is always an oil paint wash. We can buy one of the many pre-mixed washes which are available on the market these days, or we make our own wash for a mere fraction of the costs, using oil paints and lighter fluid. The basis for our self-made wash are the two colors Bitume and Smoke by 502 Abteilung. The ratio is about 50-50. Then I add the lighter fluid and mix it all together. I don't care much for any mixing ratios in this case, I just have a gut feeling for what I need. If you add more lighter fluid, the wash becomes more discreet. If you add less lighter fluid, the wash becomes darker. Now the oil paint wash gets applied on the entire model without any caution. The heavily thinned oil paint accumulates mostly in the recessed details and areas, which get accentuated this way. But even when applied on an even surface, the wash has an effect. It makes the surface a bit dull and dirty, which is exactly what we need for a tank model. The wash dries very quickly, but not very evenly. The result looks quite blotchy. We can't keep it that way, of course. A little bit of post-treatment is necessary to get rid of those blotches. To do this, I dampen a flat brush with a little bit of lighter fluid and wipe off the excess oil paint and the blotches. This works because the oil paint can be reactivated with the thinner. You can be very selective by using a small brush or just use a big flat brush like me. Thanks to the short drying time of the lighter fluid, we just keep going without any interruptions. As a nice side effect, we get a couple of streaking effects while doing that. The result is much more convincing after the post-treatment. The recessed and raised details got accentuated by the wash very nicely, and the flat surfaces of the model look a little bit more dirty and grimy now. The surface became pretty dull in the process, but to get a proper matte finish, I spray on a layer of matte varnish. We continue with the paint chipping effects. You may apply them prior to the oil paint wash, but in my opinion, this tones down the paint chipping effects a little bit too much. Depicting paint chips on German vehicles tends to be a bit more complicated in comparison to the T34, because we have to represent several paint layers on our StuG III. Almost all metal parts of German armored vehicles during the Second World War got painted with a reddish primer first. The actual color of the vehicle got applied on top of that. Once this top layer chipped off, the reddish primer coat resurfaced. The bare metal only became visible after even more wear and tear occurred, and the primer coat chipped off as well. The look of that can be seen on this restored vehicle. In the first chipping pass, we only depict the initial paint chipping effects, using German oxide red by Life Color, which is a pretty good representation of the reddish primer. I simply dab on this color with a piece of foam material. This is a very easy and effective way to create some convincing chipping effects. The main focus should be around the edges of the model and those areas which naturally see a lot of wear and tear. However, it does not hurt to add a few chips right in the middle of some big panels. The effect may not look very striking here, but it's very easy to overdo it. I advise you to be extra careful here. In this particular case, I apply quite a lot of paint chips on the model, especially in comparison to the T34 of the previous video. The StuG III is the older vehicle of the two and had a very long route of advance, probably hundreds of kilometers with a lot of combat. Besides the simple paint chips, one should also add a few scratches. A thin brush works best for this task. The exhaust pipes become very hot on such vehicles, which has also a bad effect on the paintwork there. Due to the heat, the paint flakes off very quickly. This means we have to pay extra attention here. As you can see, I apply a lot of paint chipping effects there. In addition, I apply another oil paint wash on the exhaust pipes, which is meant to give it a somewhat burnt out look. During the second pass of the paint chipping, we add the deep chips, which go down to the bare metal. I'm using Revell Matte 91 Iron again. The paint gets also dabbed on with a piece of foam. This time I'm more cautious and apply less paint than in the previous stage. Ideally, you dab the metal paint right on top of the reddish paint chips. This creates a fairly convincing effect, which mimics the two paint layers on the real vehicles. For more precision, I also like to use a thin brush. To supplement the effect, I love to use the slightly outdated dry brushing technique. For that, I'm also using Matte 91 Iron, which I brush on with a medium-sized soft brush. This step adds a little bit of metal sheen to the model, which I simply love every time I see it. The surface doesn't look like painted plastic anymore, it looks more like painted metal now, at least in my eyes. This finishes the paint chipping effects and we can get to the dust and mud effects now. This works just like on the T34. I will use fine sieved earth from my garden, which I mix with Ponal Express PVA glue and some water, to create some kind of dirt wash. Finally, I add a single drop of washing up liquid. It breaks the surface tension of the water, which makes it easier to apply the wash. I apply the wash on the entire model without any special caution or care. The final look is not yet of any concern at this stage. The same dirt wash gets applied on the tracks as well. That's how the model looks like after the wash has dried. The effect is of course too strong and uniform, so it does not look very realistic at all. We have to rework that a bit. The excess dirt gets simply brushed off with a moist brush. We keep doing that until we like the effect. This works because the Pronal Express PVA glue is water soluble. If we have to, we can remove the dirt and dust effect entirely again without any risk of damaging the paintwork or other parts of the model. There are so many weathering products on the market, but hardly any of them is so simple to use and mild as the dirt PVA glue water mixture. You can't ruin your model with it. Usually we have to repeat the process maybe 2, 3, or 4 times, each time reducing the amount of dirt and dust on the model. Just keep brushing it off until you like the effect. In this case, I gave the model only 2 passes, because I wanted my StuG III to look pretty beaten up and dusty. It has seen many months of combat on the Eastern Front already. The T-34 does not look as dirty and dusty in comparison. For more crude mud effects, which can often be seen around the suspension of such vehicles, I use the same dirt PVA glue water mixture, but this time the mix is a bit thicker. In this case, it's also not necessary to add the washing up liquid. I dab and smear the sticky paste onto the axles and the lower hull of the StuG III. As soon as it's all dry, we can install the tracks. The metal tracks are easy to handle. Just put the tracks around the wheels, connect the ends with a thin piece of wire, and glue the tracks to the wheels with a bit of superglue. Thank you. Our model looks very dirty and dusty already, but the scene we want to depict on our diorama is set in late autumn. This means that the dirt and the mud effects have to look a bit more fresh. Like on the T34, I'm using the oil paint Industrial Earth by 502 Abteilung again, which I thin down heavily with lighter fluid. This oil paint wash is used in several passes to tone the dirt effects down, until the dry appearance of the mud changes to a darker and fresher look. You don't have to focus on the suspension alone. It also makes sense to include some areas of the upper hull as well. That helps to blend in the effect. In order to depict fresh and wet mud, I use the same oil paint, but without any thinner. I just brush it on and take advantage of the greasy shine of the oil paint. In this case, it's very important to give the mud the same color and look as on the T34 model. The look has to match. This gives the impression that both vehicles operated during the same ground conditions right before the crash happened. This completes the painting and weathering process of the StuG III. I hope you found the procedure I showed here interesting, and maybe you feel like giving some of these techniques a try. If it's possible, please let me know how those techniques work for you and whether or not you like the results. I guess that pretty much any modeler could reproduce those dust and mud effects without much hassle. But of course there's a difference between a theory and its practical application. In the next part of this building review series, we will paint and weather the BMW motorbike and also take care of the figures. Thank you very much for watching, and till the next video, your Hamilkar Barkas.